And it talks about the fact that when we gather together as a church, it's like rain hitting the earth. And so it made me think of today, and I just want to read this. It talks about why we gather as the church. This author says, at all times and in all places, the gathering of the saints is like fresh rain sent by God to strengthen his people. Christians gather to worship, not because it might be helpful, or if our leaders plan the right service, or if everyone smiles at us with the perfect degree of sincerity, or handles the small talk seamlessly and engages with us at just the right depth of conversation. We don't gather to be cool because we're not. Sorry to break that news to you. We don't gather because there are just enough people our age, because that's not the point. We don't gather because we're safe, because in many places of the world we're not. We don't gather because it's easy or convenient, because we don't follow a Savior who carries a pillow but a cross. Instead, we gather because we're saved. We gather because we're forgiven. We gather because we are one. We gather because we're redeemed, reborn, and commissioned to take the gospel to the ends of the earth. We gather because the God we're worshiping has instituted our gathering as the main way he matures and trains and comforts us. It is not just when the songs or prayers or sermons touch our souls right where we need to be touched. We meet because God builds up his people through our meeting every time, in every place, without fail, no matter how we feel. Like rain in the fields, it's how our gathering works. So let's ask God to bless us. God, we do gather in your name, and we gather because you are worthy. We gather because you've called us to gather, and we've gathered because you have something to say to us and to train us up so that we can reflect you in this world. And like our gathering, we can be like fresh rains in a field. So God, build us up, refresh us this morning so that you can be glorified. In Jesus' name I pray these things. Amen. All right, Mr. Hume.
Amen. Well, we have a few things to announce this morning. We're glad to have you with us, first of all. I'm looking forward to receiving some rain on my soul this morning and, just hearing from God. And that's why we gather. So we're glad to have you here. It's a blessing to be able to gather as the body of Christ. Just a couple quick announcements. One, we're in the midst of taking a worship survey. If you haven't taken it yet, you could still do that, though the results have started to come in. And good news, we think we're at the point now where we'll be able to allow people to choose whichever service you'd like to come to. What we did is we did the worship survey, and it looks like, as far as keeping social distancing, that we'll be within our appropriate numbers for either service. And so, starting in July, you'll be able to choose freely from the 9 or 11 o'clock service. Now, with that said, there will be fewer people, at least it looks like there'll be significantly fewer people choosing the 11 o'clock option. And so if you want to be distanced, if you want to be more social distancing, that's the service to come to. It makes more sense. You'll be able to have fewer people. I don't think the 9 o'clock service, we believe it'll be within the proper distancing guidelines and things like that. But we just wanted to make you aware that the 9 o'clock service will probably be larger, the 11 o'clock service a little lighter as far as attendance. But we're excited that you'll be able to come and choose whatever service you want. So if you're here, you know, just because your last name says so this morning, you get the choice next week to choose the 11 if you'd like. So we're glad to be able to do that. A couple things to let you know about graduates. Starting on July 19th, or we can do it before that, we're going to be honoring you. And so we're excited that Sunday morning. We want to take time to really just honor that next step in your life. And so if you'll let the graduates you know about that as well, if you're a graduate, we want to see you that morning if you can make it on July 19th. We'll do that during the 9 and 11 o'clock service. Hey, we're excited too. It won't be long. Right around the corner, Christian Family Day will be here, Saturday, July 25th. And as part of that, especially with the late start, they could use your help. And so today at 2 o'clock, there's a Christian Family Day meeting. They're going to be meeting here at the church to kind of figure out some of the details, kind of get some of the assignments laid out. And so if you can be an assistant, if you want to help during Christian Family Days, I know David would love to have your help. And so I'm sure he's nodding his head behind me. And so show up today at 2 o'clock for that. All right, I think that's it. Again, you could always go to our Church Center app to find out more information about all the different things going on, things happening. With that said, let's stand, let's worship together. That's what we've come for. And so let's sing out to the Lord.
Sing to the King. Guys are here. I'm glad when everybody's back. I know it's a little bit different. I've been looking at some of the survey results, and comments are interesting sometimes. Some of the things that we hear and see, and some people are saying, I just want everybody to be in here. Yeah. So when they do come back, I want them to make sure that they're seeing people that are excited to be here, so they want to stay. You know, we're a little light up here this morning again. Of course, Dan's on the drums, and he's always gets scared, but I think he does a great job. You know, it's not like throwing a basketball to a wrestler. I mean, he's doing a good job. And Craig's back with us for today, so he's been out for COVID, and
everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. And everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life up again. I give my life to follow, and everything I believe in, now I surrender. Let the whole world see we're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see we're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see we're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see we're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, he can move the mountain. You take it. Forever, the author of salvation. Jesus conquered the grave. Oh, Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, the author of and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Eternal God, unchanging, mysterious and unknown, your boundless love, unfailing, and grace and mercy shown. Bright seraphim in endless flight around your glorious throne, they raise their voices day and night in praise to you alone. Hallelujah, glory be to our great God. Frail, helpless in the storm, surround us with your angels and hold us in your arms. Our cold and ruthless enemy, his pleasure knows our harm. Rise up, O Lord, and he will flee. Let every mountain, every field and valley of the earth, let all the moons and all the stars and all the universe sing praises to the living God who rules them by his word. Yeah. Glory be to our great God. Hallelujah. Glory be to our great God. Hallelujah. Glory be to our great God.
Father, we love you. We praise you. You are worthy of all honor and praise, and we've got the life that we have in you, Lord. I pray that you would just open our eyes this morning as we sing. Open our eyes, open our hearts to the goodness of your word. Help us to see you more clearly, Lord. You are sovereign, and let us remember that this morning, that you are the sovereign King, the Creator. You've made it all. It belongs to you. Help us to see that and recognize that. God, my heart, as you know, I've been wrestling with you all week. And I don't know why I do it, because you always win. And it's probably a good thing, because if it was left up to me, I'd mess it up. So, God, I just pray for your spirit to fill this room, to put a fire in our hearts. This world needs Jesus, and help us to be those people that make it happen. We want to be a part. So God, we give you this time so that we may be equipped with the truth of your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right. Please find 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 in your Bibles. We're going to cover more than two verses this morning. I seem to go like two verses then 12 or something like that. So we'll cover quite a bit of ground this morning. As we open our Bibles there and look at that, I just want to kind of put this thought in your mind, that today it's hard to gauge somebody's motivation, and I'll put it in our modern context, is we've, I think, all acknowledged it's hard to determine who we trust anymore, who's telling us the truth, at least the truth we understand, and whether it's political or whether it's pandemic. Like, what's the truth? It's just hard to get to that. And one of the reasons is, I just, again, put this thought in your mind, is we sometimes doubt the motive of the person talking to us or that we're hearing from. And sometimes we don't like the way they handle it. So let me just get real here again. Whether it's the politics, I mean, have you ever just scratched your head and said, that person says A and that person says Z, and they're both convinced that they're telling you the truth, and there's no way they can, somebody's lying. I mean, that's where I land on a lot of times. And the same thing with all the medicine and the pandemic and all that. It's just hard to get to who's telling us the truth. And sometimes it's because we doubt who they are or what their motives are. Sometimes we don't like the way they say it. We don't like their method of saying it or their mannerism of saying it, because for instance, with the racial, there is a discussion to be had there, but burning down cities, you know, is the wrong method, in my opinion. And so we have this, there's something good to say, but it gets lost in the way it's presented. The other thing is, sometimes we don't agree with what we're told, and so we doubt what's going on there. And I'm saying all these things in an order for this reason. As believers in Jesus Christ, those same doubts come to us as we're trying to present the message of the gospel to somebody, because sometimes they don't trust our motives. They think we're in it for some other reason. Sometimes they don't like what we have to say. They don't like the message. Sometimes they don't like how we say it. And so what Paul is going to do in this section of his letter is defend himself, I think, against some of those same accusations. That those that opposed him said, this guy's just coming because he wants to do this, or he doesn't believe what he says. And he's accused of being wrongly motivated, telling lies, of doing it the wrong way. He's accused of all those things. And in this letter, just like it works in our political world, it works with the gospel. And so while we look at our world and say, I don't like the way it happens there, I think this morning we can learn, okay, then how should we present ourselves and how should we present the gospel? And I think Paul can teach us in this area. So I'm going to start in verse 1. I covered 1 and 2 last week, so I won't rehash that. But verse 1 says, you know, brothers and sisters, that our visit to you was not without results. We had previously suffered and been treated outrageously in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God, we dared to tell you his gospel in the face of strong opposition. For the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as those approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please people, but God who tests our hearts. You know we never used flattery, nor did we put a mask on to cover our greed. God is our witness. We were not looking for praise from people, not from you or anyone else, even though as apostles of Christ we could have asserted our authority. Instead, we were like young children among you. Just as a nursing mother cares for her children, so we cared for you. Because we loved you so much, we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. Surely you remember, brothers and sisters, our toil and hardship. We work night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preach the gospel to you. You are witnesses, and so is God, of how holy, righteous, and blameless we were among you who believed. For you know that we dealt with each of you as a father deals with his own children, encouraging, comforting, and urging you to live lives worthy of God who calls you into his kingdom and glory. And we also thank God continually because when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as a human word, but as it actually is, the word of God, which is indeed at work in you who believe. For you, brothers and sisters, became imitators of God's church in Judea, which are in Christ Jesus. You suffered from your own people the same thing those churches suffered from the Jews who killed the Lord Jesus and the apostles and also drove us out. They displease God and are hostile to everyone in their effort to keep us from speaking to the Gentiles so that they may be saved. In this way, they always heap up their sins to the limit. The wrath of God has come upon them at last. Okay, let's pray. God, help us to learn from Paul's defense here that our motives matter, how we say things matter, the truths to which we hold matter. And I just pray as we study his life and how, again, he defends himself to those accusing him, that we would learn. And as those in that church did, may we hear your word as it is, your word, not the word of a man, but coming from our Creator, our Maker, our Savior. Change us, God, and help us to reflect your glory as we do. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, the first thing, again, is Paul's motives. He comes at this, and he's going to say, he's trying to say, I'm making a genuine appeal to you. There's no other reason for this. So in verse 3, he says, the appeal we make. Appeal there is the word, it's where we get, like, Holy Spirit. It means paraclete, it means come alongside. Paul is trying to come alongside people to help them, to encourage them. And I just stopped right there, and I thought, what a great attitude we would have if when we understand, or if anybody understands, that God is here for us. He's trying to get us to do things that are good, right? They're not bad. We have a dog, a dog named Charlie that I've mentioned before, and he got confused recently because of some work we were doing and stuff. He used to go outside the back door, and then he went outside the front door. But to dumb little Charlie's brain, when he wants to go outside, he heads to the back door. So it took us a while to say, no, it's the front door, and we'd have to go almost walk him up to the front door. Well, then we changed that around again, so now he goes back out the back door, and he's all confused now. He doesn't know where to go. Charlie's a dumb animal who doesn't know his masters are trying to help him get what he wants, or get what's good for him, or gets what he needs. He needs a master to help him do that. We are dumb Charlies when it comes to what God is trying to do, and people are. If we would just understand, God is really trying to move us in the right direction, the good direction, ultimately that brings glory to his son direction, then we wouldn't be so confused, and we certainly wouldn't fight it. We wouldn't be staring at this door when God's saying, you need to go out this door. Well, what Paul is saying is, we're coming alongside you to help you, to tell you the gospel. And he says it does not spring from error, meaning it's not untrue, or is it unpure or impure? So some people will share their faith for personal reasons, selfish reasons, that it'll make them look good or whatever. And in Paul's day, if you could gather a crowd, if you could actually make a living off of it, people would say that you're doing it for the wrong reasons. He would say later on in verse 4, we're not trying to please people, but please God, though. That's his motivation, is ultimately to be right with God. And so we must check our motives and make sure when we're trying to share the gospel, when we're trying to present the gospel to somebody else, that it is not because of anything that we're in us selfishly. It's because these people that don't know Jesus need to know Jesus. And it's more important what they think about God than it is what they think about us. And then he says in verse 3, nor are we trying to trick you. Literally, that means bait and switch. I was talking to Jeff Maxwell earlier about fishing. It's a fishing term. He says, we're not putting some shiny lure in the water just to catch you. That we're not doing that to trick you. That we're not appealing to your flesh just so that you'll go along with this. And this is a little subtle, I think, but sometimes we put our religion up there as this is what makes life good and easy. You know, if you want your best life, then you need to follow Jesus. The gospel, though, confronts us as much as it comforts us. It will challenge us on who we are. And false teachers, and Paul would face this over and over, false teachers will appeal to our flesh. They will appeal to what makes us feel good about ourselves, what we want to be true. And sometimes we will tune out when it says otherwise. And so any teaching that just makes us feel like, convinced that we're right in everything, that ought to throw your antenna up and say, wait a minute, that the gospel will confront us. It teaches us first that we're all sin, or sinners, that we need a Savior. And so if your Bible reading and your Bible teaching and what you hear from me, all it does is appeal and give you a pat on the back and say, way to go, you got it all figured out and everything's going to be great now, then either I'm not doing it right or you're not listening to it right. There's times when it's going to confront us. And if everything that we hear comes naturally to us, then we probably ought to repent, because the gospel is not natural. The gospel challenges us. And so I just thought of that. It's so easy. I can't remember which Sunday I said this. It's so easy just to gather around everything that we like to hear because it makes us feel good that we've got the whole world figured out and we're right about everything, and there you go. I'm just telling you. I don't care how right you are, you're not right with God on everything, and the Bible will challenge that. And so he's saying, listen, I'm making a genuine appeal to you. I'm not trying to lie to you. I'm not trying to trick you. I'm telling you the truth, and sometimes that will make somebody unpopular. Which brings us to point B. He doesn't care about being popular with people. He's looking for God's approval. So verse 4 says, on the contrary, we speak as those approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. And approved by God means he's been vetted. This is a political year again. We'll hear this over and over again. Are the candidates being vetted? Are you able to ask them tough questions? Are you able to see if they're, you know, worthy of the position here? And what Paul is saying is that God has vetted him. Not only has God vetted him, Paul got vetted by the churches too. There's stories like in Acts chapter 9 after he got saved. People were afraid to talk to Paul because why? He used to kill people like them. And so they were afraid of him. Acts 9 says they were astonished. Isn't this the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem? Hasn't he come here to take prisoners of the chief priest, as prisoners to the chief priest? He tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he was really a disciple. And eventually God said, no, I approve of him. The church has approved of him. So he was one vetted. He was approved by, and he was entrusted with the gospel. Now, this is a point that we need to understand, because every time I hear of stewardship in the church, it is we are stewards of God's resources, the money that he's given us, and we are simply to give back to him and as a steward would do, that we are just entrusted with those resources. I've also heard it in the lines of spiritual gifts. If God has gifted you in a certain way, then make sure you're using that for the body of Christ, for the cause of the gospel. You've been entrusted with those spiritual gifts so that it can be used in the kingdom of God. What's interesting here is Paul doesn't talk about money and he's not talking about gifts. He's talking about we have been entrusted with the gospel. Think of this. If you have been saved, if you know the gospel, that is not just to end with you. You have been entrusted with that knowledge. You have been entrusted with that gift. You are now to be a good steward of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That you are entrusted with the mysteries that God has revealed, Paul would say to the Corinthians. That he would say to Timothy that the God has blessed me and entrusted me, he would say that he has preached what has been entrusted to him to Titus. If you are a Christian and you have not shared the gospel, then your stewardship is lacking in that area. A professor that several of us had down at Midwestern, named Donald Whitney, he wrote this thing about we are to be growing in this discipline of sharing the gospel even. He'd say, the discipline to steward our resources, and I would say and steward the sharing of the gospel, is to be intentional and God-glorifying and gospel-driven. It doesn't arrive fully formed with the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. It must be cultivated. Stewardship must be a discipline, for there's always something else clamoring for our resources. Without discipline, the best intentions to use our time, talent, and treasure for the gospel will be overwhelmed by circumstances and the feelings of the moment, resulting in inconsistency or, at worst, neglect in our resources most effectively for the gospel. Those who were considered faithful stewards were intentional. They were disciplined about using their master's resources that he temporarily entrusted to them. So this is a challenge for me of the day, that we have been given the gospel to give to other people. And what are you, what am I doing intentionally and in a disciplined way to share that gospel with the world around us? It may mean very seriously you have to put a reminder on your phone that says, share Jesus with somebody today, or look for opportunities to do that. I'm going to discipline myself that I will mention Jesus Christ today to somebody. That's what Paul was. He was entrusted with the gospel. And that goes to his motivation. He would say there in verse 4, we're not trying to please people, but God who tests our hearts. He will say over and over, God knows, as God is my witness. He's standing fresh with God there. But he's saying, I am not here to please people. I'm here to please God. And he knows our hearts. And so many of us fall into that we're trying to win the approval of human beings. That's the way he would say to the Galatians. He says, if I'm still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Jesus Christ. If that's our motivation, then we will do what he says in verse 5. We will use flattery, but he says, I never use flattery. Came up with a fun definition of flattery this week. Flattery, by the way, is when you tell somebody something nice, but you're really serving yourself. You want them to think good of you, or you want them to do something for you. Flattery is selfish. A compliment is, I'm really giving you a compliment. A blessing is, I'm really giving you a blessing. A flattery is, I'm doing this so you'll think differently of me or you'll do differently for me. And one person put it this way, gossip is saying something behind somebody's back that you would never say to their face, but flattery is saying something good to their face that you would never say behind their back. We do that. To get our way, to make a case, we'll make people feel good and we'll flatter them. And the reason it works is because we love flattery. In fact, the psalmist says we love flattery so much that we don't detect our hate, our sins. And so he's saying, I'm not telling you as he would, I thank God for your growth. He's not doing that for any selfish reason. He's just blessing them in that way. And here's the joke that I tried to make last week. He did not put on a mask to cover up our greed. God is our witness. He's not cashing in on this. He's not putting a different face on him so he can personally benefit from it. Folks, if sharing the gospel and seeing others one to Christ is about us, we'll never do it because it's going to be a hard road. But he said, I'm not doing this to cover up anything in me. If we were not looking for the praise of people, not from you or anyone else. Our job as Christians is not to try to please everyone. Believe you me. We are in a day and an age when you cannot please everyone. You can't please half the people. It used to be you say something new, some people would be mad at you, but now I don't care what you say, it's going to feel like everybody's against you. It's just there are so many opinions and somebody's free with those right now that if you're looking to please people, or you're not going to go very far with sharing the gospel. You're not going to go very far with saying you believe in Jesus Christ. There's Vance Havner says this, and it's not just applying to the preacher, it's applying to all of us, I believe. He says it's not the business of the preacher to fill the church, but to fill the pulpit. It's not the business of the Christian to be popular, but to share the gospel. That's what Paul is doing here. And he says in verse 6, even though as apostles of Christ we could have asserted our authority. He had some weight behind him, but he wasn't going to demand it. He was going to do what Jesus did. And this brings us to our second point. He was going to be meek. He was not going to demand, you must listen to me, or try and force them into it in any way. He was going to be meek. And before I get into this, here's the challenge with this characteristic of Paul. When you are meek and mild, as Jesus was, it opens you up to criticism, and it opens you up to anxiety. The criticism is this, that because you're not as vocal and you're not as brash and you're not as confrontational as those without Christ are, that you don't care. I mean, again, if I can just be very real today, it's not enough just not to say something. You better say it in just the right way, and it's not enough to be silent about something, because then you're accused of all kinds of things. When you are meek, to use Jesus as the example, you open yourself up for crucifixion because you don't fight back. And I'm not saying be silent on political issues. As I said last week, we live in a country where we can actually voice our concerns and vote our conscience and all that stuff. But when it comes to this, Paul acted like a child, he says. The other thing I said is it opens you up for criticism. It opens you up to anxiety, because we have this idea that everything depends on me. I don't know what it is, and I can't promise you anything, but God is at work, and God is going to do some amazing things. And the anxiety comes when we don't trust that. We don't see that. So, he says under meekness, A, they were warmly loved. Verse 7 says, we were like young children among you. Like a nursing mother cares for her children, so we cared for you. This verse, your version may be slightly different. There's some differences here on how it's translated, and it has to do with the Greek language. And just to give you an example, this is kind of a biblical study, I don't know, tip or something. A few weeks ago, we were up in St. Joseph, and there was a big storm coming through, and we were at a thrift store, my wife and her sisters, and we were all just kind of deciding, should we go, should we stay there, what should happen? And one of my sisters-in-law went outside, and you could see dark, imposing clouds coming. And there was also a man outside who looked a little odd. He just had crazy white hair. I don't know if he was homeless. I don't know what it was, but he looked out of place, even in a thrift store, if that makes sense. And he just looked weird. And my sister-in-law, who just spoke out loudly, that sky's crazy. Or that sky looks crazy in the face of the guy that looked crazy. And everybody around thought, she said, that guy looks crazy, like right to his face. What she really meant was that sky looks crazy, but it was so close. In the Greek right here, literally there's one word that either belongs at the end of one word, or one letter that belongs at the end of one word or the beginning of the next. And depending on how you do that, he either says, we were like young children among you, like a nursing mother, which is what the NIV says, or the whole thing is about being young children, nursing a mother. Does that make sense? So just so you know, if your version, I don't know why I spent time on that. There you go. I just want to tell you a story about the crazy guy at the thrift store. So, but both are true. The idea here is that there is warmth, there is love, there is meekness here. And what he says is his concern for them is deep, and he cares for them in a way they can't understand. It's the way Jesus, when he would look at Jerusalem, say, you've killed the prophets, you're going to stone me, basically. And I, like a chicken wants to gather you under my... Paul really had a deep concern for the people he was sharing the gospel with. And we need to come to that. And here's my fear for me. I write people off. Whether it's a sinful issue, whether it's a political issue. And my concern drifts from, they need to hear the gospel, to, you disagree with me, and so we're done with it. That's where our priorities need to stay where they need to stay. We need to understand that God loves even sinners, because we're the worst of them. And that the gospel, the presentation of the gospel, is what must be front and foremost in our minds. It's hard to do that, though. It's so hard to do that. But he loves them dearly. Secondly, he calls them to live a worthy living or worthy life. Verse 8 goes on to say, we loved you so much, we were delighted to share with you the gospel, not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. He was involved in their lives at a deep extent. And one of the ways people will know that we're telling them the truth, that our motives are right, is when we're involved in their lives. It's not the topic of the day, but Rosaria Butterfield, I get her name mixed up, was a homosexual woman who lived next to some Christians, and they certainly disagreed with on the area of their ethics and their morality. But they welcomed her into their home. They ate dinners with her. They had tough conversations with her, always in a kind, loving way. And it was because they not only shared the gospel with her, but their lives as well, that she eventually got saved. And she's just a strong voice for God's grace and redemption in that world right now. Because, as Paul did, they shared their lives, not just the gospel. Point C I have is witness labor. Verse 9 says, you remember, brothers and sisters, our toil and our hardship. Paul's saying not only did we work outwardly, but the hardship part is this: we were tired doing it. It was just, we wore us out. We worked night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preached the gospel to you. That's his tent-making activities. Verse 10, you are witnesses, and so is God, of how holy, righteous, and blameless we were. Those are three characters. Holy, we live holy lives. We're separated from sin. We try not to sin in our lives. We're righteous, which means justice, and we need to consider that in our day. And we're blameless, and that basically means that no accusation would stick. But if somebody came and said, your pastor did this at the drink station at Quick Trip, you know, he cussed me out and he cut in line and he did all that, I would hope, and maybe I'm wrong, maybe you watched me too closely over 20 years, that you would say, that doesn't sound like George. That surely, now maybe I did, maybe I was having a bad day. They've got videotape, you can go check it if you want, I know. But what he's saying here is when we're blameless, it doesn't mean we're perfect, it just means that goes against who we are in Christ. And accusations against a Christian should not stick. And then point D is they learned wisdom. Verse 11 says, you know that we dealt with each of you as a father deals with his own children. This should have been my Father's Day sermon last week, but I slowed down. And what he says there is that we, as fathers, as he did, encouraged them. That's that same word of come alongside and push alongside. Comforting and urging you. He challenged them. He comforted them, he cheered them on to do what? To live a life worthy of God who calls you into his kingdom and glory. He would talk about this to the Ephesians and to the Philippians, that we are called to live a life that fits into his kingdom, that fits into his glory. When you picture heaven, when you picture walking around heaven where there's no more tears and there's comfort and there's encouragement and all things are good, we ought to be packing for that trip today, if that makes any sense. Some of the youth are going off to Camp Hope this week, and in our house that meant we need to make sure we had some snacks and some, I can't think of, a sleeping bag and a pillow and your Bible. You had to be ready for a few days away at this different setting, this different location. And if for a week away we will think about what we need when we're there, then for us who are Christians and think that we will live forever in God's kingdom, then we need to think, how do we behave in God's kingdom? How do we act in God's kingdom? What do we need in God's kingdom? Because we pray this every day, don't we? Or we should. Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Heaven is not something we can't wait to die to get to. It's something we should be praying for and working for right now. That's the way it works. That we should be packing for heaven if we can. And so when he says there that you live a life worthy of God, that you're going to live in his kingdom, it needs to fit together. And his message, this is point three. What is he trying to tell them? Well, first of all, he's saying thank you that you receive God's word. This is point A, verse 13. And we thank God continually because you, when you receive the word of God which you heard from us. Received means not just that you opened your ears and listened, you applied it, you put it, you received it in that way, you listened to it, you accepted it. You accepted it not as human word, but as it actually is the word of God. This, for me, this is what drives me. Last week, I was very burdened. I don't know if you could feel that, but I knew I had to say some things that I just thought were from God's word. And today's the same way. Every Sunday is kind of that way. Y'all don't want to hear what I have to say. You really don't. I've got opinions galore. I've got thoughts galore. But it's God's word that we bring. It's God's words that we must apply. And it's God's word that we will be accountable to obey. I read a great illustration at this point about a man who traveled to England, and guess what? He got a traffic ticket. Anybody want to guess what the traffic ticket was for? Driving on the wrong side of the road. And here's what the judge said to him. He says, you're not responsible for the laws of your land. You're responsible and will be judged by the laws in our land. Folks, these are the laws of God's word. And we should understand that I don't care what your heart says, I don't care what your world says, we're responsible for the law of God as revealed in his word. The problem is we like driving on the wrong side of the road, or sometimes we don't know that. That's why it's important to be in the word of God. But he goes, you accepted it as it is, the word of God. We're not just responsible for it, but he says in verse 13, which is indeed at work in you who believe. God's work, as Paul would write to Timothy, is useful for teaching, rebuking, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. When you're in the word of God, it'll change your mind, it'll change your attitude, it'll change your heart to where you will start seeing God at work in your life. You will overcome sin, I believe. You will begin to share the gospel, I believe. You will begin to serve others. But some, this is point B, resisted God's work. Verse 14 says, for you, brothers and sisters, became imitators of God's churches in Judea, which are in Christ Jesus. That was a good thing. You suffered from your own people the same thing those churches suffered from the Jews. So that suffering, that there's a persecution following Paul and following the believers everywhere. They killed the Lord Jesus, verse 15 says. And in the Greek there, the emphasis is not just that you killed Jesus. You killed Jesus who is God. You killed the Lord. You killed Jesus, the Son of God. There is no higher crime than that. And you killed the prophets. If you read the parable of the tenants in Luke's gospel, it's like, I sent my messengers, and finally I sent my son, and you killed him too. And you also drove us out. That's Acts 17. They displease God. This is huge because he's talking about Jewish people. He's talking about people who think they're pleasing God, but they're not. They're actually on the opposite side of that coin and are hostile to everyone. I don't know why that phrase jumped off at me this week, but it just seems like there's a lot of people that are discontent about everything and mad about everyone. And if we're not careful, we will again get so mad and worked up about everyone else that we forget that we're to share the gospel with them. And here's why, verse 16 says, in their effort to keep us from speaking to the Gentiles. God's very people were not pleasing him. They were just causing a fit everywhere because they didn't want the Gentiles to hear the gospel. I've tried to make that make sense to me. Is there somebody I dislike so much that I don't want them to know about Jesus? And my Sunday school answer is, well, of course not. My practical answer is maybe there is. Again, because of disagreements or whatever else, them hearing the gospel becomes secondary. And I might not go out and try to shut people down like the Jews were doing, but who's keeping us from talking to people about Jesus? You know the answer to that? No one. Absolutely no one is saying you can't tell people about Jesus right now. Which leads us to believe if we're not telling people about Jesus, who's telling us not to tell people about Jesus? Us. And the reason they don't want them to hear is verse 16, so that they might be saved. Notice the connection there. You must speak to somebody so they, this is Romans 10, speak to them so that they can hear about Jesus so they can get saved. How can they be saved if they don't hear? And yet the Jews didn't want them to hear the gospel because they wanted to be the ones in charge and the ones in control. And the sobering part of all this is point C, they were recipients of God's wrath. Verse 16 says, in this way they always heap up their sins to the limit. God is patient. He wants everyone to repent, but there is a limit. I think in the outflowing of the gospel, the story of the Bible, in fact, that God was working with the Jews and they rejected Jesus. And so now it goes out. Their time had come and gone. And he had reached his limit with these people. Jesus, again, when he talks to the nation of Israel, he goes, your house is left desolate. Sin had run its course and accomplished its purpose. There would be no doubt that they deserved God's judgment. That it was overdue, and it was obvious they warranted it. Verse 16 says, the wrath of God has come on them at last. Here's how the wrath of God literally came upon them. Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 AD. Their center of religion, everything they were trying to prevent from going away by sharing the gospel with the Gentiles, was destroyed. They rejected Jesus. Their only hope of salvation was gone. That's how God's wrath came on them. And fortunately for us, Jesus took that wrath. John 3, everybody knows John 3:16, for God so loved the world. But I love how it goes on, verse 18. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. Verse 36, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on them. We find ourselves at the exact place that they find themselves. You either accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, there's nothing you do to earn salvation, and you have eternal life. Or you don't, and you reject that, and God's wrath remains on you. That's the choice before us. That's the choice every human being must make, and that's why, like Paul, we must have the right motives. We must seek God's approval. These are your application points. Make sure your heart is right, that you're trying to please God. You must do it in a meek manner. Your mannerisms must be quiet and gentle, like a father or like a mother. And live a life worthy of God. You must have the right message. You must hear from God's word and share it to others. And you must have the same mission that Paul had, which is share that gospel with other people. Let's pray. God, thank you for your word. It is your word. And I pray that we receive it as that early church did. I thank you, God, for Paul's motives and the way he shared that gospel in the face of harsh opposition. And I pray that we learn, God. I pray that our motive is the same, to please you, that we are meek and gentle as we present you to the world. God, that we share the message, the clear message of the gospel, and that we are on mission to do that. We are intentional and deliberate as we have been entrusted with the gospel, just like Paul has. God, may each one of us here in this room and that watching online know that we have made a decision to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. And because of that, your wrath has been removed. And for those who reject, God, may it be clear to them that it remains on them. We love you and we thank you and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and let's sing. Thank you. God, you are worthy. May everything that we say and think praise you. You are worthy, God. You're the King of kings and Lord of everything. Thank you for meeting us this morning, God, and send us out from this place as those entrusted with the gospel, approved by you through the blood of Jesus Christ. And God, may we seek to please you above all others. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you. Thanks for joining today. And just remember, next week you can come to this service or the next, either one. But thank you so much for your flexibility and patience as we've kind of waded through all this. And just keep praying that God would guide us and go out there and share the gospel, okay? God bless.
Noodle.